And that is visuals of our guest in the studio. She is an Afrocentric soulful jazz artist, and her name is Shady Blue. Today, she's going to take us on our journey through music, what she's been up to, what is expected of her, and we get to wrap up the show, wrap up the conversation, playing her latest single, Better Without You. But thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
How long ago did you do that video?
4 years ago. I just had a baby, my second child.
Wow.
He was actually 2 months old. I had him at a video shoot, feeding him, rushing back, feeding him. Yeah, so yeah, I just 4 years ago.
When you look at that video, you know, I'm sure there's some sort of nostalgia, the memories, you feel like...
Definitely, that day, yeah.
How does it... What are some of the things, when you look at your life now, and you look at your life at the time, do you look at that video and think, oh, I should have done this differently, or I should have done that differently? Have there been any regrets or
lessons? When I look at my life now, I just say I'm blessed. That's all I can say. Because then I was... honestly, at that point in time, I was at my lowest, but I was trying to get myself back on track. And now I am a lot stronger and back to where I want to be and better, actually.
All right, so you moved out of Nigeria a long time ago. You're based in the UK.
Yes.
How has that been? Because it does seem that we want to give an honest picture of what living in the UK for Nigerians, you know, what the situation is. We know that everybody's reality is different.
Yeah.
But there's just this expectation of Nigerians that once they leave Nigeria, their life is better.
Exactly.
Once they go to the UK or the US. From where you stand, what is the true picture?
The true picture is life in the UK is not easy. It's really, really hard. And I can honestly tell you that the happiest times of my life is actually here in Nigeria. I was born and raised here in Nigeria, and like I was saying, as I was talking to you off the camera, saying, I sleep and I dream of Nigeria, but I wake up and I find myself in reality again. I'm back in London. I'm like, oh my God. So it's really, really hard out there. Here is more family orientated. You get people helping you. You find childcare easily. Over there, everything costs money. So basically, you're working to pay for childcare and stuff. It's really hard. You have to work twice as hard to be able to live a comfortable life over there, believe it or not.
And here you can afford to pay for a cook, get a nanny for your kids,
a driver. This is luxury over here. So if I was to work twice as hard as I was working in London and live here, I think I'll live a very I'll live like a queen.
But are there plans for you to come back?
Definitely. This is where I think my happiness actually is here, and I would love to really come back. And so don't be surprised if you see me this time next year and I'm already here. I'm a local.
How do you think this would, your kids would react to this?
Because my kids will love it. I believe they will love it. Kids adapt easily anyway, so it wouldn't be a problem for them. I'm sure of that.
All right, you took a brief break from music. Mm-hmm. Why was that?
So I took a break from music because I had children, and my children are my blessing, and I had to focus on raising my kids to a certain stage. I'm focusing on them. I also have my day job as well. I also have my business as well. So there was too much, and I had to like have a balance in my life. So I took a short break, not too long, maybe about 7 years. But while I took the break as well, I was still recording anyway. So right now I have so many songs. I have up to 2 albums worth of songs ready to be released.
Brilliant. Mm. There's this thing about, you know, we say that women, it's a bit difficult to achieve balance. You said that you had to take a break to be able to find that balance. Some people say that balance is only a myth that can never be achieved. Mm. Some say that balance is understanding what needs to give for other things to survive.
Yeah.
You know, which school of thought would you say that you're
I think
for?
Balance, you can find balance if you want to. And you can also not find balance if you don't allow yourself to find balance. So basically trying to weigh things out and trying to let some things go, maybe temporarily, to be able to find yourself again. There has to be a work-life balance. If there isn't, you might end up going crazy. Even though I'm talking to myself as well, because I hardly sleep. I survive on like 2-3 hours sleep a day. I'm used to it, but it's not healthy. So I'm still trying to find the best balance. But at the moment, I think I've got kind of like a balance already, in a way. It's working for me so far.
How would you say that motherhood has impacted your life and your career?
Motherhood has made me become more of a patient person. Before, I'd like something done like yesterday, where it made me become a more patient person and someone that actually appreciates life even more, because now I have a reason to do the things I'm doing because I'm doing it for my children. Being a mother is just the greatest blessing ever.
Oh, that's so sweet. It's, you know, it's really warm to hear. So let's talk about your music. Mm. You said whilst you were away from the major scene, you were behind the scenes recording songs.
Sure.
Give us an insight into what, you know, a day in your life was, you know, bringing up kids and writing music. What gave you inspiration to write music? Was it, you know, your kids, or were there like moments where you had to just wait for the kids to sleep before you write songs? Give us an insight into life of
you said it
a
all.
Writing mother.
It was difficult, but I usually write from my experiences and the things I'm going through. So the worst moments and the lowest points of my life were the moments I actually wrote the strongest songs, because I wrote straight from my soul, my heart, and I was able to express myself more. And you're right, I have to wait for them to be sleeping before I can have actually become creative or find that quiet space of mind, maybe when they're in school or at the childminders, to be able to actually do my writing.
Would you want to share maybe just a snippet of, you know, these lowest moments that you talk about?
Lowest moments, like going through, like when you become a mother at first, you don't even know where to start. They say it all comes naturally, but honestly, there are some moments where you kind of... I'm a superwoman, but then that superwoman goes out the door. I could break down and be like, where do I start? When the baby's crying, you don't even know what to do. And being a single mother of two children as well, and having a day job and also combining it with my business, because I do have another business for curvy women, Jean, a denim line, and also combining it with being a mom is not easy at all. And like I said to you, in the UK, it's different. You don't get any help. You're on your own. It's a very lonely life in the UK, but I can only say it's the grace of God that kept me.
Thank you for being, you know, really honest and open. We're going to break, and when we come back, I'd like us to talk some more about, you know, depression, because what we find is that a lot of women who have babies, but they're not being briefed on what to expect.
No.
They just tell you that once you have your bundle of joy, you forget everything, but that's not the reality of a lot of moms, and we need to have conversations about postpartum depression. Mm. We're speaking about postpartum depression, which we are going to speak all about right now. Mm-hmm. Now, here in Nigeria, there's starting to be more awareness about postpartum depression. We're starting to pay more attention to mental health and maternal mental health, which wasn't always the case.
Yeah.
But at the time when you went through yours, would you say that you experienced some form of postpartum depression? Did you get support, and were you able to speak up?
I feel I did, but I was quite ashamed to actually speak to anyone about, any professional about it, because I don't want to be seen as someone who's got mental problems or bipolar or something. But it is real. I did a lot of reading. I did a lot of soul searching. I read a lot of books as well. So I get myself educated on whatever it is I'm going through. Any medical issues, I usually tend to research about it myself and find ways to deal with it. And there are support groups online. So if there isn't one here already, it would be good. Even social media platforms is a great way to create support groups for such things. It's not just postnatal depression. It's also women issues as well, such as polycystic ovaries, endometriosis. They don't know about it here. And I actually had both, and I still have both. But there's no awareness. People are ashamed to talk about it, that I've got this. But if you're able to let others know that you've got such, then you can help them to see how you're helping yourself.
It's so heartwarming that you share that you have PCOS.
Yes.
Because usually when we hear that women have PCOS, they say, oh, your chances of having a baby, they're slim, but you've had two children.
Exactly.
With endometriosis, it's the same thing.
Exactly.
Chances of having a baby. Exactly. And you have both conditions, and yet you have two miracles.
So being able to share that with women that have been told that you would never have children because you have this condition, and being able to share that success that you did, is really good for other people. So it's really, it would be good to have, I've created a support group on Facebook already for it. And there's a network out there. So if you just search for PCOS on Facebook, you will see a lot of support group, and also postnatal depression.
But what would you say to someone who's watching you that is in that point where they have just been diagnosed to have PCOS, and maybe they've been trying to have children and they don't have yet, or someone who's dealing with endometriosis?
Yeah.
It's something that we're becoming aware of, but not a lot of light is being shed on it. As,
no,
you know, people
you don't
just
even know
that
you have it.
You know, they don't know. They just only have maybe painful or heavy periods, but they don't know what exactly...
Or they're gaining weight.
Exactly. Yeah. So we don't have a lot. To just, I only know of one organization that speaks about endometriosis.
Okay.
But, and I know PSN Africa, Postpartum Support Network Africa, speaks for postnatal depression. But we need more awareness.
Yeah.
But so for someone who's within that space that is, you know, hoping to have kids, you have kids.
Mm-hmm.
Out of all of this, you have your own kids. What would you say to that woman?
Never give up and do a lot of research. If you go online, there's a lot of information about this condition. So don't just stick to what the medical expert has told you. Changing your diet could actually help. Also, changing your lifestyle helps as well. So there's simple, simple things that you can follow that's actually available online that you could follow.
All right, thank you so much for sharing
this.
Now, with your music, what informs the genre of music that you do?
Okay, I grew up from in a house of music. I'm from the Abodeyrin family, and everyone knows that they're really musical. My father is a jazz musician, so my background is actually jazz music. However, I used to be a part of a group called JJC and 419 Squad back in the day. I was a singer in there.
Nice.
So that actually exposed me to African music, but it was then called Afro hip hop. So when I actually moved on from JJC and 419 Squad, I formed a girl group. You know how girl groups are, we don't last. So I was the only one that survived.
We need to change that narrative.
I know. But then I was the only one that survived the girl group and became a solo artist, and I started to chase my dream. But I continued doing jazz. However, the way African music has evolved lately has really inspired me. With Nigeria is now on the world map. I'm so proud to say I am Nigeria anywhere. Back in the day, it was Jamus. Jamaicans, they're all the one. We want to be like Jamaican. Even when we're in JJC and 419 Squad, it's like Nigerians wanting to be like Jamaicans. But now you can say, I am a proud Nigerian. We are Africans, like
Africans,
JJC said. Exactly.
Ah,
exactly. So I decided to now start fusing that. My brother kept on saying it to me. My guitarist kept on saying it to me. You need to put some African in your stuff because that's where you're from. And you sing well in Yoruba. You sing well putting that African dialect into stuff. So that's where this new album came from. It's actually my third album I'm working on.
What's the name of the album?
It's going to be called My Way. It's not out yet. It's called My Way because it's either My Way or No Way. Not really. But it's going to be called My Way. And I've released six singles so far from it. It's all on all online platforms, and I hope to release it before the end of the year.
So we're going to play a song. Let's have a feel of what you're about.
Yeah.
The six songs you released, you know, this is one of them, and this here with Doing It Without You.
Better
Without You.
Yeah.
It's part of the album, right?
Yes, it is.
Great. So let's get to have a feel of what Shady Blue is about, and when we come back, we'll be speaking some more with her as regards that particular song and what's next. My days. I had to ask when the video was played, is that you? Is that you?
It is.
You look
me.
Like fire.
Oh, thank you.
So that song, I like the feel. You know, it has a bit of a Jamaican, reggae type feel to it. How did you come about that song? And Better Without You sounds like a writing to an ex.
Okay, not necessarily. Everyone says this to me. You know, this song was actually co-written by myself and my producer, TBO. So basically, we came up with the idea because a lot of women go through breakups in relationships. And I'm not going to speak about women only. Men go through it as well. So basically, this song is about getting your power back, getting your independence back, getting your confidence back. Because when you have a breakup, it takes a lot from you. Either you're a man or a woman, you become depressed, you become low, you don't feel good about yourself anymore. And then after a while, if you do work on yourself and don't drown in that heartbreak, then you can work on yourself and empower yourself to come back strong. And then realizing that, actually, I am better without you. That's what the song's about. I'm not going to go into any more details than that.
Okay. I'm going to try not to ask any more personal details. But that's a really lovely song. How long did it take you to write the song? How long did it take you to shoot the video?
It didn't take us long at all because TBO is based here.
Okay.
And believe it or not, we work remotely. So I record the vocals out there. We write together remotely. Everything is done remotely. The video was shot in London, and it took a day to finish recording that video. But it was hectic. Hectic.
When you play your video for your kids, how do they react?
They're so proud of me. My kids are so proud of me. They tell the teachers in school, they tell everyone, I'm a shy person when it comes to family matters and all that. So I don't like this school to know I'm a singer. My day job, I don't let them know what my personal life is about. But everyone's proud of me. Even my boss where I work now is like, wow, you're fire, you can sing. Everyone just spreads the word for me. So my kids are proud of me.
That's so heartwarming.
Yeah, it is. It surprises me sometimes. But again, I guess it's the glory of God.
I'm really just so happy for you. And
thank
I really
you.
Like what I saw. And I'm hoping that Nigeria opens its arms warmly towards you, saying that you're coming back again.
It's tough. It's a tough market.
I know. And seeing as you're looking to coming back to Nigeria, like moving back, I hope that all your dreams come true
in
the best possible way.
Thank you so much.
How can people follow up with you and keep up? So let's talk about your support group.
Okay.
For women who are dealing with PCOS and endometriosis, who need more information, I need a support group. How can they reach out to you?
They can actually just go on my Facebook page, Shea the Blue Singer. And then the groups in there, there's a support group for PCOS on there. On Instagram, my Instagram page is Shady Blue Singer as well. On YouTube, I'm Shady Blue One, Shady Blue and the number one. And what else? Twitter, I'm Shady Blue Singer as well.
All right, just before I let you go,
Shady
Blue, is your name Shade?
My name is Fola Shade Abodering.
So how did you come up with the name Shady
Blue? Okay, so when I was in school, everyone used to call me Shady because I'm Shade. Yes.
So they couldn't pronounce your name?
No, it's just a slang, like a nickname maybe. And then my favorite color is blue. And I also sing the blues too. So I just thought Shady Blue and it sounded good at that time. Even though I've been having people saying to me, that name sounds shady, but I'm not a shady person.
That's why I said Shady
I'm
Blue,
not
but
a shady,
shady
person. No, I'm not. Thank you.
Oh, thank you so much for joining us. I'm wishing you all the best with your new forthcoming album, as well as all your singles. Please keep up to date with all that Shady's been up to. And if you want to be a part of our group, if you've been told or you know someone who's living with PCOS, please tell them to check out her Facebook page, Shady Blue Singer on Facebook, and then check her support groups. Lend your voice, be a part of it. Your pain can become your purpose. Your mess can become your message. She's had her two amazing kids. She's pursuing her career, and she's doing absolutely well. Thank you so much for joining us.
To enjoy more of this, our Ogonge videos when you just watch, press this button to subscribe on top of our YouTube page. You go love her.